Are we going live? Sound check, sound check. Okay, is the sound good?
A few words about the Sunrise Movement. A lot of you know these things, but not all of them, I think. So a lot of people know that the Sunrise Movement played a pivotal role in the passage of a Green New Deal, making that a national priority. And they did that, some people might remember, by organizing a sit-in at the office of House Speaker Nancy Pelosi in 2018. So for me, that was a vivid memory. That was the date in which I started donating to the Sunrise Movement, because I thought, these guys have chutzpah, and I want to support what they're doing in every way that I can. So after that, upset election victories of Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Edward Markey, who beat a Kennedy for the first time in Massachusetts, they started work on the Green New Deal resolution. So they co-authored that, and then after that, every Democratic candidate for the presidency in 2020 had some version of a New Deal a bill that they were proposing, and that included Joe Biden, and his was called the Build Back Better Act, right? So before the Sunrise Movement and its demands for the passage of a Green New Deal, we should remember that every effort to pass climate legislation failed. And that goes from the Clinton BTU tax to the Obama administration's Clean Energy and Security Act of 2009. And that was defeated by the fossil fuel industry and its enablers in Congress. So the Sunrise Movement and the concept of the Green New Deal completely turned the tables on the opposition, because what happened was, instead of defending legislation that would impose a carbon tax, raising the cost of gas and energy for every American, we basically pivoted to a Green New Deal that would provide money to enable new business to start up and money for new jobs for a majority of Americans in the country. So we broadened our constituency, in essence, and built a huge movement that supported the passage of a Green New Deal. And because of that, it proved impossible for even Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema to stop it, even though they did what they could to reduce the amount of money that went into it. So I want to say just a word or two about what's good in the Inflation Reduction Act, because I think a lot of people have the impression that Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema weakened it to the point where it's, you know, just almost not worth the paper it's written on, and nothing could be further from the truth. So what it will do is it will reduce greenhouse gas emissions 40% below 2005 levels by 2030, according to the Rhodium Group and two other work groups that modeled it. Then that will leave 10% further reductions that we need to gain somehow to meet the United States' nationally determined contribution of reducing greenhouse gas emissions 50% below 2005 levels by 2030. And so there are various ways that we could do that. On top of that, the tax credits that the Inflation Reduction Act provides for putting solar panels on your roof, installing a heat pump as part of your HVAC system, buying EVs, which everybody I think knows about, those tax credits are not capped at $370 billion. Most people think they are, they're not. And so there have been estimates that the amount of spending that the government does on those could go as high as, you know, maybe even $900 billion. Second point, $60 billion from the Inflation Reduction Act is targeted to disadvantaged communities and communities of color to eliminate pollution there and repair environmental harms that have been inflicted on those communities, a lot of which we know about, and also to provide opportunities, jobs, startups for businesses to participate in the green economy. And so when I took my Poly 10 students to the Los Angeles Clean Tech Incubator just last week, I found out something else new, and that is that there's money in the CHIPS Act to replicate versions of the Los Angeles Clean Tech Incubator in 40 cities around the country. And the Los Angeles Clean Tech Incubator is designed to train residents from low-income communities and communities of color for jobs in the green economy, and also to facilitate new startups for residents in those communities as well. So if you want to start a business, that is in any way related to the clean energy economy and sustainability, the Los Angeles Clean Tech Incubator can help you get a leg up on that. So all of this is not to argue that environmentalists and their allies can just declare victory in the battle to preserve a habitable planet. There's still another 10% of greenhouse gas emissions reductions to enable the United States to meet its nationally determined contribution, like I said, and then there's the woeful underfunding of international climate finance by the United States and the continued build out of fossil fuel infrastructure, which could potentially lock fossil fuel extraction and greenhouse gas emissions in for more decades. But because of the interference of the fossil fuel industry and partisan gridlock, we failed to effectively address the climate emergency for so long that we now have to dramatically step up the level of our ambition to hold global warming to the 1.5 degrees Celsius maximum that's likely safe enough to keep us from crossing dangerous and destabilizing tipping points. So like the scorpion in the parable of the scorpion and the frog, the fossil fuel industry continues to engage in a strategy of deception, deflection, and delay that consign us to a hell on earth. But with the passage of the Inflation Reduction Act, the transition to the green economy is being supercharged. Solar and wind energy are already less expensive than fossil fuels, and before 2030, EVs will be less expensive than conventionally powered vehicles. EVs will also get 500 miles on a charge before 2030 and way less because of the development of new and improved battery technology by then. So we are winning the battle for the future, and the Sunrise Movement is leading the way to help us finish the fight. We look forward to hearing more about that in a few minutes. But first, I'd like to now take this opportunity to thank the Climate Commitment and Environmental Justice Committee for helping to make this Earth Day lecture possible. In particular, I'd like to thank and introduce the two remarkable co-chairs of the Climate Commitment and Environmental Justice Committee, Tanya Anders and Ira Babtawali. They are both incredibly hardworking. That is an understatement. There's no way that I can say how hard they work. There's just no superlative that really puts that into words. They're also talented, smart, and creative women who are helping the college to make a quantum leap forward in terms of the organization of sustainability efforts on campus. To say that, however, while true, is to leave out one of their best qualities. They are also great leaders of the CCEJC, as we call it, because they believe in lifting every member of our team up so they have an effort to contribute their talents and their ideas to sustainability efforts at Mount SAC. For that reason, I believe the CCEJC offers the warmest welcome to visitors and newcomers. That's an invitation to all of you. And the most rewarding experience for regular members that keeps them coming back. Please join me in welcoming Mount SAC Sustainability Coordinator Tanya Anders and Sustainability Director Ira Babtawali to the stage to tell us about the revision of the college's climate action plan and sustainability at Mount SAC.
James. Very, very kind introduction. Thank you so much. So James already introduced us, so we're going to just get right to it. We wanted to just share some nice visuals with you to so that you can all see how much is happening on our campus related to sustainability. The video won't play here. We've tried, it won't work. We have an introductory sustainability video that is actually, you can find on our sustainability website. And I've shown it to my class. Hopefully more and more faculty will show it to their classes as well. Basically, we are committed on our campus to infuse sustainability into all of our work. And if we look at the next slide here, then you can see what that entails is the three main pillars of sustainability, which for short we call them by the three P's: people, planet, and prosperity. And if you hit one more time where they overlap, that's where we see us here at Mount SAC. So what we're going to do in the next couple of slides is very quickly show you how these three pillars are visible on our campus, and then also some things that maybe aren't visible, so we just want to mention them so that you're aware of them. So we have as the first pillar the people, and really, as you'll see, they all really all overlap, but we just decided, okay, some will focus on some areas. So people is everything that includes you connecting with others, you being here, you learning from each other, you taking care of yourself. We have food on the table, right? You taking care of your wellness, you taking care of your social engagement with others and your families, your friends, and hopefully you see the Mount Sac family as being part of that. The diversity that we have here in the room, that is representative of our diversity of our campus and so important to all of us. And so one brand new area on our campus where you can go for your wellness is the new wellness center. So if you have not walked over there, do yourself a favor and use those amazing facilities that are there for you. There's all kinds of things that you can work with. I don't like these machines personally. But what I love is on the next slide. I love to swim. We have a brand new pool. So those are amazing, amazing new facilities for you. And so if you haven't gone over there, please, I encourage you. It's part of your well-being. The next slide shows the new student center, which of course is going up just down the hill, or is up, we should say. And the opening is just around the corner for that, which will be another wonderful area for you to go and to engage with other students. It is also a building that is going to have LEED Gold certification. And so, and Ira always knows this abbreviation better because she's an architect, but it's leadership in
energy and environmental design.
Energy and environmental design.
And a quick note, you might want to just keep note of some of the things that we're mentioning today, because mm-hmm. we might have some prizes at the end. So that might or might not be one of the prizes.
What goes into getting these LEED certifications for buildings is actually a lot. It starts with, how are you going to haul off the trash of, say, you tore down an old building, and where is all this going? Where are you getting your construction material from? How much transportation goes into that? How is your building going to run? Is it going to use mostly electricity, or what is it going to run on? How good is the lighting going to be in there? How much natural light is there? How is the health of the air in that building? All of those things. So this will be a LEED Gold building, which we already have, you know, LEED certified buildings on our campus, a couple of them. So if you look around, they'll have these plaques on them. So that'll be an amazing new building for you that we'll have no later than the fall. The next one shows the new pedestrian bridge. That's what you use to get over to that amazing new wellness area, as well as, of course, all of our other athletics facilities. So that's to keep you safe, because we want all our people here to be safe. So use that bridge. And now we'll transition from people to planet. So I'll let Ira do that part.
Yeah, so Mount Sac actually is doing so much in terms of really upholding and respecting our planet very locally, but really setting a model for others. Many of you might already know about the Wildlife Sanctuary. Can I get a show of hands? How many of you have been to the Wildlife Sanctuary? Eagle Club, of course. Okay, if you have not gone, you must go. It's an absolute gem on our campus that very few people actually know about in the community. I feel like everybody in our Mount Sac community needs to go there. One of the reasons that people don't know about it actually is because it doesn't have a prominent entrance. And so this is something we're working on. So in the fall, you'll see a sign and a much better welcome to the Wildlife Sanctuary. There'll also be some ancillary spaces, support spaces, lockers, and restrooms so that you can actually store things and then take a trek inside the Wildlife Sanctuary. So once it becomes available, please, please go and visit it. It is a wonderful testament to how Mount Sac is really upholding our planet. Another example is the urban forest. So, you know, a concrete jungle is pretty much what we live in LA County, right? So every bit of a square foot that we can get when it comes to foliage or vegetation is really like just gold. We have an urban forest in our midst here on campus, and it's quite significant. So we actually have done a tree inventory. And we have 3,079 trees on our campus. Those trees are doing a lot of work secretly, quietly in the background, right? They're sequestering carbon, they're capturing stormwater, they're removing pollution from the water and from the air. They're absolutely precious to us. And so our inventory keeps track of all of those amazing assets that we have on our campus. In addition, just recently, we purchased 72 acres of wildlife that we're going to preserve for the lifetime of our college. We're not going to develop it. We've just preserved it. It could have easily been developed. I shouldn't say easily, but it could have been developed. But we've chosen to actually keep it as is. And again, that land is doing so much work because of the natural vegetation that it holds. Also, we've actually engaged in habitat restoration. So just across the street at Grand and Temple, if you guys have looked up, you might have seen this sign on the west parcel. So that piece of land was actually slated for development, but the college decided, you know what, we're not going to develop this. We're going to actually restore it to its original state. So we went in there, removed all the invasive weeds, and actually brought in recycled water. And we've already seen the benefits of this hard work. So the California gnatcatcher is actually an endangered species. We've actually seen it nesting already. So we've seen the benefits of this. And we've actually, as I mentioned, implemented recycled water, which we intend to bring to the rest of our campus's play fields in the very near future. So that's a really big living laboratory for us right in our backyard. In addition, you might have noticed something new to our campus, some new receptacles. So we've always done a pretty good job of collecting trash, landfill waste, and recycling. But just this year, we introduced organics collection. So at the cafe, at Prime Stop, and over by BCT, where we have our kitchen, you'll see these what are known as big bellies. And these are actually a pretty cool piece of tech. They have Bluetooth, so it tells our custodial staff when they're full, so custodians don't have to come out and service them unnecessarily. They're powered by solar panels up on the top. They compact the trash, so they save a lot of space. And as I mentioned, they now include a composting receptacle. So you guys, we're going to start collecting all of our organic waste and being able to document how much methane we're going to prevent from going into the atmosphere as a result, which is part of our climate action plan. And then electric vehicles. So in 2035, in the state of California, it's going to be required that any new car sales have to be electric. So we're phasing out of fossil fuels as a whole at a state level. So to boot, that means that we have to provide the infrastructure on our campus. We have 59 charging stations on our campus. Now, majority of them are located across the street by the athletics facilities because that's where the new construction was happening, but we intend to bring them into the main part of campus as well. So in 2035, if we have new students and if they happen to have electric cars, that means that this is a central hub for them to charge at an affordable rate, and that matters to us. So that's a big deal in terms of prosperity. And then solar panels. How many of you have solar panels near your neighborhood or in your neighborhood or have been to a school with solar panels? So Mount SAC wants to come up and join you in terms of solar power. So we're looking into introducing about 2.3 to 2.7 megawatts worth of solar that's going to offset about 20% of our energy use. And we're going to phase more and more of that in over the next couple of decades. So we're starting this process and we have really good momentum. So we're really excited about really becoming good financial stewards, because that's part of sustainability and part of prosperity as well.
To continue with the prosperity, your prosperity too. Did you know that we have a sustainability award for our students? So please go to our website. You can win up to $500 for a project that you do with one of your classes. You only have to be enrolled as a Mount SAC student, and you can submit your work there. There's a little bit of, you know, writing involved, but I think Gladys, for example, with Eagle, right, you guys have won before. So there's some examples of projects. We often get design students that make garments out of tea bags or recycled material, and student groups like that do park cleanups, volunteer work you might do. So please take a look into that. You might be able to earn $500 this semester or at the end of this year. Through some project you're working on right now. We also are really proud of growing our internship program more and more. We have helped students place them in external internships, but we are currently also doing in-house internships, and this right now, this semester is insane. We took on like 9 students, which probably will be less next year. But we really want to provide that opportunity for you, for first of all, to earn a little money, which not all internships are paid, but
even if they're not paid, keep in mind those are things to put on your resume, and ultimately that will get you a job and that will help you with your prosperity as well. So we hope that you are interested in exploring these options and you can come to talk to any of us to learn more about internship opportunities. We also have, as part of our prosperity, a very healthy and robust curriculum. So we have courses that are designated now, and you can actually search for them in the course catalog. When you look for classes to take, you can put in sustainability, and all the courses that have a little leaf on them, those are the ones where the faculty have, first of all, taken a faculty professional development course that allows them to even get that leaf, and those that have then committed to infuse sustainability into their classes. So please look for that logo. And Ira, you'll...
Yeah, so as you can tell, Tanya and I tag team a lot. And the beauty of it is that we really understand that sustainability isn't just all operations, you know, how a campus operates from day to day, but it's also curriculum and education. And just like the People, Planet, Prosperity nexus, that nexus between the two houses, if you say, when it comes to how we get things done on campus, is really crucial. And that's what we're really actually quite proud of, because that's, I think, very rare when it comes to universities and colleges. Usually there's something, one role that handles everything, but this is a very collaborative role, and we want students to be a part of that conversation as well. Now, how we get it done when we do the climate action plan this year, we have a huge effort going on right now. Every 5 years, we have to update our climate action plan. We did the last one in 2018. The next one's going to come in 2023. And so we have several focus groups. Students, of course, are invited to join this effort. Everything from energy, waste, transportation, but also curriculum, professional development, outreach. And as a whole, we develop a climate action plan together that then gets published in 2023. As you can tell, a lot of work has been done. A lot more work is required still. And so that climate action plan is both looking backward, but looking ahead at the next 5 years in terms of what we need to be and where we need to be in terms of climate action. And then we have a decarbonization plan underway. So as mentioned, California intends to be off the gas reliance, off gas reliance by 2045. And so it is in keeping that Mount SAC looks really hard at our fossil fuel use on campus. And so we're crafting together a decarbonization plan. So every 10 years or so, we'll be able to phase out of our fossil fuel reliance, whether that's energy or where we're looking at our infrastructure in terms of vehicle use and bus use, even how much water we're using. All of that requires fossil fuels. And so this decarbonization plan is going to provide us with a roadmap for how we can phase out of that reliance over time in a very logical and financially stable way. We hope to be done with that decarbonization plan in the fall as well. And we don't have to reinvent the wheel here. The California Community Colleges Chancellor's Office has put together a roadmap for us to sort of gauge how we're doing. They've put together goals for all the various categories that we've been talking about today. And so we don't have to just make this up as we go. We get to score ourselves essentially against this rubric. In addition, the California state has a roadmap of its own, as mentioned, 2045 is that big goal. And so the infrastructure's in place, the policy's in place, we have awesome momentum, we have really great critical mass, and we can do amazing things here on campus.
And so to relate it back to you, the students have really changed in their view also over the last couple of years. And if you look here, I pulled up some data from a report from 2022, and it shows here younger Americans are more accepting and engaged with global warming than they were in last decade in 2012. So an increase by 13% to 81%. So 81% of young Americans are aware and accepting that global warming is a reality that we're living. And it's really important to have that acceptance, because only if you're understanding that, then you're also willing to make changes in your life and to fight for the rights that you have and to make your voices heard, which of course happens through elections also. And we have, you know, our political sciences faculty here to
to hopefully emphasize that in the classes to how important it is for you as a citizen to make your voices heard. So lots of things happening there. One of the areas that we are proud of also that as part of our institution, we have made sure that sustainability is getting more and more on the forefront. So if you ever look at campuses, also say if you're looking into transferring to another school or when you research Mount SAC before you came here, you might have looked at, well, what does this campus stand for? What are their college goals? What's their mission? What's their vision, right? And so we are very proud that sustainability is now part of our core values. It's part of our vision. And so, you know, there's a couple of quotes here. But we're very proud of that because our Board of Trustees just approved that in September of 2022. So that's still pretty new. And so we keep pushing that. So now you can win a prize. So let's see how well you paid attention before we turn it over to our keynote. We have six prizes. Okay, so what are the three pillars of sustainability? I saw this hand go up first here, actually. Okay, people, planet, prosperity.
Okay, next question. By what year does Mount SAC plan to be carbon neutral? I saw Eric. 2040. Almost. Uh-oh, I think I saw yours first, a second rather. Almost, it was 20. I'm so sorry, I didn't actually see which one was next. Okay, go ahead.
The gentleman with, yeah, I think it was you, yeah.
Me?
Nope, the one with the glasses well behind here, the big hand, glass table.
Yes, yeah. Yes, that's the answer. We just need that advance.
Question. How many trees do we currently have on the Mount SAC tree inventory?
I saw you right here. Yes.
Oh my goodness! I thought you remember that number.
All right. And then the next question, in which year will you no longer be able to purchase a new fossil fuel operated car in California? Oh, I wasn't looking.
Is 2035
is correct. All right. Next question. What percentage of young Americans ages 18 through 34 understand that global warming is happening? Yeah. If we have several people. Yeah. 81%, yes. Okay, last question. What is the minimum green building standard for this campus? Previous. You haven't won yet?
No.
Okay, Eric.
Lead silver.
Anybody else?
Carbon.
Any other takers? Go for it. Okay, thank you so much for participating in that. Thanks for giving us your time, and we're going to pass it over to Raul Madrid.
Hey, everybody. I'm Professor Raul Madrid. Before we start, though, I want to be sure that you all know that there's pizza on your table. We don't want you to go home hungry, so eat the pizza. I'm here to introduce our keynote speaker for today, Josiah Edwards. So I'll have a little bit to say about him, and then Josiah will come up and give his talk. Josiah Edwards is a climate justice organizer based in Los Angeles, California. He grew up in the South Bay of LA County, near the largest refinery on the West Coast. Living in the South Bay, Josiah experienced environmental racism in his daily life, something that communities of color feel all too often. Josiah is currently a member of the Los Angeles chapter of the Sunrise Movement, a 501c4 political action organization whose goal is to elect proponents of renewable energy and oust those from elected office who do not refuse funding from fossil fuel industries. Now, as a member of the Sunrise Movement, Josiah works to uplift the voices of youth, that's you all, in frontline communities by training young people on organizing methods and discipline needed to build a multiracial, cross-class solidarity. Such solidarity will enhance the prospects of enacting climate policies such as the Green New Deal. Josiah's work has been featured in the New York Times, I'd encourage you all to watch that video, Common Dreams, and Democracy Now!, among others. Please join me in welcoming Josiah Edwards to Mount SAC.
Okay, do I have to get close to this? Or is this good? Can y'all hear me? Hear me fine? I'm used to yelling, so I can get really loud. I want to thank, extend appreciation and thank you to Professor Stone for the invitation, as well as to, let me think if I can get all this, it's the Eagle Club, as well as the, was it the Sustainability Committee? Who helped make this happen. Thank you for having me. I will give a kind of like disclaimer, which is like some of what Professor Stone already went over is gonna be a big part of what I talk about, at least 50%. I'm gonna go a little more in depth. Some people may be disappointed or, you know, sad about what I have to say, but it is what it is. I'm in this fight to build power. So that's kind of all I got. And with that, I think I can get started. And last thing is, I don't have any slides. I like to talk. I love the sound of my own voice. And that's why I'm here. All right. Give me a moment. The climate crisis is here. As we are enduring this crisis, there is an ongoing, widespread, and well-organized fascist assault on democracy and public institutions attempting to prevent us from investing in the solutions needed to survive it. The war is being waged on several fronts, but among the most important and most strategic is public education, which the corporate elite, Christian fundamentalists, and self-serving right-wing politicians view as a social battleground that represents the broader fight for investment in people and the public good. They have long called into question the role, function, and very existence of public education. I should also add that I got back on a trip from DC like 2 days, so I'm still like a little loopy. So they have long viewed the and called into question the role, function, and very existence of public education by assailing it as a bloated waste of tax dollars that serves to indoctrinate wokeness into the next generation. The constant fear-mongering over the teaching of Black history and the civil rights of trans and queer people act as a scapegoat that simultaneously endangers lives and radicalizes parents into support for the far right, thus expanding their base of support. At the same time, neoliberal politicians in states, municipalities, and school districts across the country invest more money into carceral practices and policies within schools while encouraging the expansion of corporate-run charter schools to eliminate teachers' unions and replace public education altogether. All of this, of course, was accelerated by the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic and virtual schooling. At the center of this battle for social and public good is the world and future young people will inherit. Despite that, young people have no real influence on the outcome of this fight because they lack institutional power, are socially, economically, and politically disenfranchised, and are disempowered in our everyday lives. However, if we ever want a fighting chance at a just, livable, and equitable future, at a just, livable, and equitable world, things must change, and change quickly. Despite the theme of this being the Earth Week presentation, I'm not here today to talk to you about trees, although 3,079 is a pretty good job. I'm not here to talk to y'all about trees. This is a presentation about power. In a world where Ron DeSantis is leading the assault on democracy in all its forms by outlawing education on Black history or even the mention of queerness, where states like Kansas are passing laws mandating genital inspection of children, where the right to an abortion and bodily autonomy has disappeared for half the country and is being attacked further given the current efforts to functionally ban, and I never get this right, is it mifepristone? Never get it right. It would be an abdication of my responsibility as an organizer if I treated this lecture as a run-of-the-mill Earth Day event. The truth is, right now, our movement is faced with a choice. Either we will do the work necessary to build and wield power, or we accept the rule of fascism, which over history has already resulted in the oppression, injury, suffering, and death of millions of Americans and people worldwide, and will result in the oppression, suffering, injury, and deaths of hundreds of millions more. This part's gonna be really quick. This lecture is divided into two parts. First, I'm gonna go over the quick history, not quick, through the history of the rise of the youth climate movement. And in the second, I will offer what I believe to be a path forward. Should be simple enough. Hope you can follow along. And with that, I'll begin with the first half. The mainstream climate movement in the United States began in the mainstream environmental movement. And you'll notice there's a distinction between climate and environment. This movement heavily focused on climate scientists and the impact of climate change on the environment. It was composed of environmental nonprofits, climate scientists, and other elite institutions, with the earliest versions of this movement not even naming fossil fuel corporations as enemies, and largely focused on presenting climate change as something that was real and endangered polar bears. This movement had little popular support outside of a niche, liberal, white, elite, adult group of folks and failed to accomplish much of anything. Again, referring to something Professor Stone talked about. By the time the Democratic Party had control of Congress in 2009, the biggest piece of legislation that the climate movement managed to get on the table was cap and trade, which was incredibly friendly to fossil fuels in general, and even that couldn't get passed. Senator Ed Markey of Massachusetts, of course, acknowledged that part of the failure of the bill was a strong lack of public support to see the bill through. The American public reeling from the Great Recession could not see themselves in the legislation and therefore had no reason to support it. In 2011, growing public unrest over the failure to hold major corporations accountable for the Great Recession culminated in what the Momentum Community, which is the organization incubator from which Sunrise Movement emerged, calls a moment of the whirlwind. Autonomous protests decrying the 1% in favor of populism sprung up around the world, which I know is a particular subject of your interest. These mass protests were explicitly focused on corporate greed and class issues, and also happened to be where many of the founders of the New Youth Climate Movement, including several of the founders of Sunrise Movement, itself got their first taste of political resistance. These young people had seen Barack Obama and the mainstream Democratic Party not only break their promises on corporate accountability, but also on addressing climate change, and were eager to see something done about it. They knew that fossil fuels were a problem interlinked with corporate greed and turned away from federal action to what they could control, getting the local colleges they attended to divest their endowments from corporations that support fossil fuel projects. These students mobilized themselves and took direct action targeting their universities, which were primarily elite institutions and private ones. Of course, you know, universities are generally elite institutions anyway. However, in the early years, victories that culminated in students winning divestment campaigns were few and far between. Additionally, the continuous pressure required to mobilize students was exhausting, and college students at elite universities were transplants from around the country who were isolated from the broader community where a university sat. Actually, before I move to the next slide, how many of the people in this room live in or around the community of Mount SAC? Yeah, my point exactly. It soon became apparent that the divestment movement was not going to be enough to win serious climate action. In 2015, Bernie Sanders launched a long shot bid for the Democratic presidential nomination with a campaign that specifically harkened back to Occupy and spoke to young people. He called for free public college and Medicare for all, and was consistent in criticizing large corporations and the ruling class while doing so. His campaign platform, along with the strong pushback from the mainstream Democratic Party against his candidacy, politicized an entire generation of young people. I was only 16 when this campaign happened, so it wasn't me. Although I liked him. In the same year, news had broken that ExxonMobil, one of the world's largest fossil fuel polluters, knew about climate change for over 40 years and lied about it. In 2016, the Democratic Party's eventual nominee, Hillary Clinton, lost the election to billionaire reality star and demagogue Donald Trump, who was a climate change denier and eagerly appointed fossil fuel executives to both his transition team and his cabinet. One of his first executive orders as president was to withdraw the United States from the Paris Climate Accords, which were still largely deferral to fossil fuel corporations and did little in terms of emissions. But it still represented something. And it was a clear blow to the fight against climate change, setting climate politics in the United States back even further. It was within this context that the New Youth Climate Movement emerged. This movement was full of young people, politicized along lines of race, class, and gender, who didn't feel at home in either the older environmental movement or the Democratic Party. They recognized that young people were set up to be the most impacted by climate change and should lead with a moral authority on it. And as climate disasters started to occur with more frequency and news from climate scientists became grimmer, they started referring to climate change as the climate crisis. The New Youth Climate Movement was explicit about the climate crisis as an urgent existential threat caused by the corrupting influence of fossil fuels on US politics. Groups like Extinction Rebellion and, yes, Sunrise Movement emerged to stage disruptive direct action spectacles targeting politicians. Some of y'all now have her book, but in 2018, Swedish teenage activist Greta Thunberg struck from school and demanded the Swedish government take action on the climate crisis, arguing that there was no point to being in school while the government did nothing to protect her future. However, Greta largely only went on strike by herself. Realizing that her efforts weren't practical for winning change, she decided to strike from school on Fridays as a tactic for continually raising awareness. Her efforts resulted in the formation of the international organization Fridays for Future, which ultimately brought climate strikes to the US. Certain designated Fridays would become massive mobilization days, drawing tens of thousands of young people into the streets across the country. Another group, Youth Versus Government, was launched solely to sue the United States federal government on behalf of several young people and future generations for its failure to act on the climate crisis, arguing that their rights as young people to be healthy, to a healthy environment and a livable future was enshrined in the Constitution. This case, while it made its way through the courts, was ultimately dismissed due to lack of standing. Sunrise Movement emerged as a prominent thought leader for the youth climate movement in the United States, able to take advantage of and steer the growing climate strikes across the country while also speaking for the movement in the political arena. Sunrise co-founders were steeped in the political resistance of Occupy, cut their teeth on divestment campaigns, and were aware of the failures of Waxman-Markey as a policy. They knew that young people needed to engage in a mass politics of solidarity that connected the climate crisis to other issues plaguing the country, aiming to do so through direct action and political protest, but also through uniting with other social movements and engaging in the electoral arena. Months after Greta Thunberg started striking from school, Sunrise organized a sit-in at soon-to-be Speaker Nancy Pelosi's office only days after the conclusion of the 2018 midterm elections. They were joined by upstart representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, or AOC, the youngest woman ever elected to office at the time. Their demand? A Green New Deal. The climate strikes and the number of young people participating in them grew as the Green New Deal exploded in the press. After being sworn in, AOC and Senator Markey introduced a non-binding Green New Deal resolution, and Sunrise staged more sit-ins and escalated direct actions, targeting political representatives, pressuring them to co-sponsor the resolution. One of our refrains was also step up or step aside. It's pretty regular with us. As the 2020 primary heated up, Sunrise intervened as well, pressuring candidates to endorse the Green New Deal and swear off taking money from fossil fuel corporations, drawing the ire of the Democratic Party establishment. Sunrise and the youth climate movement as a whole saw exponential growth in 2020. Over 500 local chapters, called hubs, were formed around the country, and Sunrise was training leaders for what they hoped to be a major organizing moment following the 2020 presidential election. The plan was to engage in sustained mass non-cooperation to win a Green New Deal. The goal was to continue to harness the climate strikes and bring those who showed up to every strike into the movement. And, you know, surprise, it didn't happen. In 2020, Sunrise endorsed Bernie Sanders for president and campaigned heavily for him in early primary states. However, this was not enough to overcome the might of the Democratic Party establishment, which coalesced around Joe Biden. At the same time, the world was mostly brought to a halt by the COVID-19 pandemic. The massive mobilizations of the climate movement were no longer viable, and the energy from the broader public for organizing around climate collapsed. Sunrise was able to pivot to virtual organizing far quicker than most other groups, but the damage to the climate movement as a whole had already been done long before the pandemic in actuality. Most youth climate groups around the country collapsed entirely. The movement was burning out organizers left and right, putting them to the extreme for electoral campaigns or massive protests that hadn't amounted to material change in their communities. The large strikes were also not truly disruptive because, well, students often got permission from either their parents or from the administration, staff, teachers, yada, 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 to leave school, and the attendees of the strikes still reflected the adult climate movement, which came before us, white and middle or upper class. The pandemic served as a radicalizing force in many respects, despite this. At the same time, as the US government left millions of workers to die, a Republican administration proved it could spend as much money as it needed and completely pause student loan payments, which means, oh, and they paid us checks. Furthermore, several municipalities throughout the country made efforts to either pause or alleviate rent payments. Then, in late May, another moment of the whirlwind hit. George Floyd was murdered at the hands of Minneapolis police, and a massive uprising of working-class black and brown youth took to the streets. It was the kind of uprising that the youth climate movement had been purporting to build. Sunrise immediately got involved in supporting the protest, clunkily becoming a climate group that embraced the abolition of police and prisons. The protests were largely spontaneous and, for the most part, lacked the clear organization to ultimately channel their energy into concrete material change. Nonetheless, they had a profound impact on the way in which many organizers within Sunrise at the time viewed their role in the fight for justice on the whole. In 2021, Sunrise would also join in protests for Palestinian liberation and in the pipeline fight led by indigenous water protectors to stop the expansion of Line 3, while also continuing to engage in electoral politics. Actually, before I move forward, how many of y'all know about Line 3? Okay, how many of y'all are familiar with current pipelines like the Willow Project? Okay, TikTok really did work. Okay. Sunrise joined a broad coalition of other environmental, racial, and economic justice organizations in pushing for responses to the COVID-19 pandemic and the climate crisis at the same time. Over the course of the pandemic, Sunrise remained the dominant youth climate organization across the country. Sunrise participated heavily in defeating Donald Trump and electing Joe Biden. Bernie Sanders negotiated a task force that Sunrise Executive Director Varshini Prakash sat on. And when Biden was inaugurated, Sunrise was in direct conversation with the White House about climate policy. Sunrise was engaged in conversations to get a very watered-down version of the Green New Deal passed, which was the Build Back Better Act. However, the Democrats had a narrow majority, and conservative corporate Democrats like Senator, well, I want to say like, but it was really just Senator Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, who stalled the bill's passage. Sunrise continued to push for the legislation, fighting to make sure that the Build Back Better Act would end on President Joe Biden's desk. Sunrisers trekked and marched, held rally after rally, held overnight occupations, were arrested blockading streets and the homes of members of Congress, held phone bank after phone bank, launched a hunger strike, and took every opportunity to hold Senators Manchin and Sinema accountable, including when Sinema was arriving at or leaving an airport, or when Manchin was driving his Maserati or attempting to board his yacht. Sunrise remained in the climate conversation, but it had also begun to internally atrophy due to its investment or its lack of investment in its members on the ground, scaling up its staff size, and a failure to address structural racism and classism within the organization. Just to note, when I say the organization, just a little bit on how Sunrise is structured, there are national staff organizers who, for the most part, set direction and strategy. And organizers on the ground, such as myself, focus primarily on the local work, oftentimes carry out that local that national strategy on a local level. Where was I? Many of the larger and more radical hubs turned away from the national apparatus, isolated, angered, or simply unsupported. Members also wanted local change that they could see within their own communities and began working to pass local Green New Deals. However, these members lacked the support necessary to pursue these campaigns, and over time the organization bled more members, whittling down its membership from tens of thousands to just several hundred. In 2022, long after Sunrise had given up the campaign for federal legislation, this is when we get to the Inflation Reduction Act, Joe Manchin decided to come back to the negotiating table, and Democrats passed the first legislation on the climate crisis in the history of our country, the Inflation Reduction Act. Many would contend that the bill was a mixed bag. It wasn't perfect, but at least it was something. Rather than offer my particular take about the bill, I'll provide you with a Twitter thread from the woman who is the movement architect of Green New Deal policies. Her name is Rihanna Gunn-Wright. And the thread starts here. I've been asked to give my take on the IRA, so here it is. The bill contains some very good, very needed investments in renewable energy, in a green bank, in electrifying key tech in homes, in credits for electric vehicle purchases, etc. It also weds those investments to very major harms, whether that's fossil fuel leases, or the Mountain Valley Pipeline, or permitting reform, or technologies that directly and indirectly harm frontline communities, or tech that will likely be exploited to prolong our dependence on fossil fuels. The list of bad things is long. And just as important as those discrete bad things is the fact that it helps lock in a dependence on cars, a dependence on environmental racism, and a dependence on extractive industries that do very little to move us towards a more just economy with new balances of power, which is a big part of what we need to decarbonize and fuel a larger public appetite for climate action. And quite frankly, as a Black woman currently holding my sleeping Black child, I simply cannot say that another bill that threatens Black, Brown, and Indigenous lives again as the price of admission for domestic political progress is something where the good outweighs the bad. That may be the case in terms of emissions reductions, but I cannot make those words come out of my lips. What I can offer is what I see as the facts. This bill contains investments that will help decarbonize and, in doing so, save some lives. Those investments come at tremendous racist costs, the full scope of which we don't know yet, but could very likely take some lives. And yet, this is the only major climate legislation in front of us, and what is likely the last opportunity to pass major climate legislation for this foreseeable political future. It's all very American. End quote. Without the consent of its membership, Sunrise supported the bill. Sunrise became an organization that supported legislation that included the same racist and otherwise oppressive compromises that were baked into the original New Deal. The organization, who claimed that the center of their advocacy was an intersectional approach to decarbonization, whose central organizing goal was to pass something called the Green New Deal, whose very namesake was FDR's New Deal of the early 20th century, and who specifically named that it was imperative for them to avoid replicating the inequities that were baked into the original New Deal, became the very thing that they were founded to prevent. And that's part one of the lecture. All right, so I'm going to take a little liberty here as we move to the next half of this lecture, which will focus on the proposed strategy for organizing in schools. As I do that, I want to contextualize this offering by taking just a moment to focus on one of Sunrise Movement's current programs, which is called the Green New Deal for Schools. I was specifically asked to talk about this. The direct goal of this program, as stated by Sunrise Movement, is to have students win environmental policies at the school and district level, namely retrofitting buildings and buses, establishing climate curriculum, establishing free lunch, creating green jobs apprenticeship programs, and having districts establish climate disaster response plans, all things that we definitely need, policies that are good and nice, fine goals to work towards. However, it's my belief that they limit what is actually possible. By focusing on these narrow policy goals, Sunrise is demonstrating an analysis that does not necessarily see students as whole. Now, what do I mean by this? Well, students are whole human beings, at least I think you are. And even though it might seem trivial to say and name this, I think it's important because we often forget this. In fact, we live in a world that specifically tries to make us forget this. High school students have families. They live and play in broader neighborhoods and communities. Some of them attend religious institutions. Some of them work and are actively providing income for their families. When we take this into consideration, it is not unreasonable to suggest that students might have other needs and desires than winning a climate curriculum or retrofitting a school bus fleet to be renewable. Like I said, this conversation, this presentation is one about power, not simply winning policy, because you need power in order to win that policy in the first place. I'll use myself as an example. I had childhood asthma. I guess this is a preview to the New York Times video if you haven't seen it, but I had childhood asthma. My father and brother have chronic asthma. We grew up near the largest refinery on the West Coast. My brother and I had a nebulizer machine sitting between our beds in the case that we ever had trouble breathing at home, and my parents didn't have a lot of money, so I actually slept near kind of an open window. That means that at night, sometimes I would have an asthma attack or have difficulty breathing, or my little brother would have the same. And so some days we wouldn't get the sleep we probably needed. And given, you know, the nature of that, right, one would might suggest that, like, you know, having grown up directly impacted by environmental injustice, I have a certain degree of insight on what might have been meaningful change for myself and my family. And what I can tell you is that it has less to do with the refinery that I grew up near, even though it does have something to do with that, and more to do with the various other social and economic circumstances we lived in. That refinery wasn't there by accident. It just didn't exist there. Even if we shut it down, we'd still be suffering. My mother's car broke down pretty often. And so we struggled with figuring out how we would get to school. My mother was also the primary breadwinner in our household, and she lost her job in 2016. So my family struggled with economic insecurity. And this was particularly true of our home, which my mom and little sister, who is 5 years younger than me, just had to move out of because they could no longer afford to stay there. The struggles with finances also caused turmoil in my parents' relationship, and they divorced in 2017. All of these issues were apparent to me as a high school student and had a direct impact on my performance in school. As a senior, I was accepted to UCLA, but couldn't attend, not because it was too expensive. My tuition was, and most of my room and board was covered by both my Pell Grant and the Cal Grant awards, but because I went from being a near straight A student to failing two courses and getting a D in another. UCLA rescinded my acceptance because I couldn't maintain my academic standing. And this is only a glimpse of what my life was like. I don't talk about the imposed isolation from much of my extended family that my father placed on me and my siblings, or what it was like being raised as a Christian and regularly attending church on Sundays and youth groups on Wednesdays as a queer Black kid. I'm not saying any of this for pity, far from it. I'm saying all of this because all of that is what shaped my life and my reality as a student. And I can promise you that the only reason I would have gotten involved in Sunrise to do something like the Green New Deal for Schools campaign as a high school student was to up my resume and then and get into a college that I wanted to get into. And as soon as I got into that college, I would have dipped. I would have stopped organizing. And so my point here is that Sunrise has to take seriously the ways in which students experience their lives. If Sunrise hopes to win anything on the scale of a Green New Deal, it must believe that ordinary people are experts on their own lives and their experiences and do the work to help them connect the injustices they experience in their lives to the systems that facilitate them. When they begin to do that, people will begin to take responsibility for affecting change in their own lives. Sunrise's base of support will expand measurably, and whole neighborhoods, communities, towns, and cities will fight for a Green New Deal. That's the lesson of the civil rights movement and the organizing done by the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, as well as that of the radical labor movement of the 30s and 40s, which won the original New Deal in the first place. If Sunrise learns this lesson, then it will be capable of building the power needed to win a Green New Deal. And with that, I'm going to move into the next part, which is about what I think we can do to actually win. The actual title of today's lecture is called Schools as Sites of Struggle. And this is the particular section that speaks to schools as sites of struggle. In his book, Undoing the Myth of the School to Prison Pipeline, Damian Sojourner articulates that while the school to prison pipeline framework may challenge the basic tenet that the meeting out of discipline is disproportional, it fails to challenge the ethos of anti-Blackness as foundational to the formation of school discipline. This idea, which is that the school itself intentionally targets Black and brown students, has evolved into the idea that schools themselves are carceral sites. That is to say, the very nature and function of schools is not merely as a feature. And when I'm talking about schools here, I'm primarily talking about primary and secondary public education. That the very nature and function of schools is not merely as a feature of the prison industrial complex, funneling deviant students into prisons, as the pipeline phraseology would suggest, but instead replicates the carceral functions of the state's prison and surveillance apparatuses. Schools themselves are carceral sites. Carceral logic extends throughout today's modern education system. In this system, young people are told what to learn, when to eat, when we can use the restroom, and what restroom we're allowed to use, what to wear, what pronouns and names we can go by. The system is rooted in control, seeking to mold young people into obedient workers and model citizens ready to participate in a racist, colonial, and exploitative society. And if you don't believe this, I know we have the privilege of living in the great golden state of California, then all you have to do is travel to Florida. In her book, Education at War, Connie Woon notes that this same environment is one that is under-resourced, features high-stakes academics, and repressive policing mechanisms. For Black, Indigenous, and Latina students, the impact of this oppression and domination are disproportionate. For young people, Both failure and success under today's education system is a no-win scenario. Failure to thrive in school rewards us with further oppression outside of the classroom through low-wage jobs at massive corporations that don't allow us to meet our material needs around housing, healthcare, transportation, and other social goods. Success leads to higher education, a commodity that is ever increasing in cost and ever depreciating in value, which is I'm assuming is part of the reason we're all attending community college. I didn't mention I'm a community college student too, but yeah. Young people with college degrees are frequently underemployed while saddled with tens and hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. These same educational institutions gentrify our communities. And if you've been to downtown LA or anywhere near USC, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And invest our money in projects that further perpetuate the climate crisis and the systems that manifested it. And whether we're in college or in the workplace, we still experience age-based oppression through draconian voter ID laws, over-policing of college campuses, or locally imposed curfews. The logic that undergirds these practices is called adultism, discrimination against young people on the basis of our age. Adultism suggests that we do not know any better because we are young, or that we're immature or easily manipulated, or that our brains are still developing, and therefore we cannot properly think for ourselves. This logic is enshrined in our laws. Young people under the age of 18 are unable to vote. School policies apply in loco parentis so that we are always controlled, even when our parents are not around. In both schools and higher education, public secondary and primary schools in higher education, student body governments are pacifying measures that often don't afford us much power other than the ability to plan school dances, while in most places, students are not allowed to sit on their school boards. Even in political projects where young people are assumed to have an explicit moral authority, such as gun violence or the climate crisis, we are often treated as political props and tokens. We are expected to be seen, not heard. This is particularly true of young people under the age of 18, but it extends to young adults as well. We make for cheap and mostly free labor under the guise of community service, no shade, but internships, and course credit. Older adults get a photo with us that make them look like they care about the next generation, while we are exploited under the guise of mentorship that peppers us with condescending refrains such as, "You'll understand when you're older," or, "I see a lot of myself in you when I was your age." The modern children's rights movement purports to be grounded in the safety of the child, but does so while upholding the status quo of adultism. Rather than giving us an equal say in a society that we have a stake in, adults advocate on our behalf to protect us from other harmful adults. And although inadequate, the children's rights movement does move us closer to recognizing the full human agency of all young people by advancing an agenda against the abuse of children. Even by this standard, however, the United States falls short, as it is the only member of the United Nations that has not ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, due in part to the same far-right Christian fundamentalist forces that are attacking critical race theory, sex education, and the rights of trans and queer people. This same conservative worldview has led to material ramifications for young people across the country. Those of us under the age of 18 do not legally have control over our own bodies when it comes to our sexual orientation, gender identity, reproductive health care, or the choice to be vaccinated. At the same time, in 43 states, those of us under the age of 18 are legally allowed to be married off to adults. We do not have the right to be in schools free of gun violence. Instead, we have police officers who have no legal obligation to protect us, as determined by the Supreme Court, often let us die or shoot us themselves. We do not have the right to a safe climate. Instead, we are pushed towards recycling, which is important, but is not the actual solution. And climate science is stricken from our textbooks. We don't have the right to safe, accessible housing. Instead, we are evicted or have our utilities shut off without little regard to how that might impact our ability to learn. The truth is, the framework of children's rights has not extended beyond the political priors of adults. Here's a question. Why do we need adults to exercise power on our behalf when we can simply build and exercise power for ourselves. Those closest to the problems are closest to the solutions. It is imperative that we reject the notion that children are merely the property of adults. People do not suddenly become human when they turn a certain age. They're born that way. I believe that all of our organizing should be premised on youth liberation, which is freedom from adultism and oppression based upon our age. As young people, particularly those of us under the age of 18, we should not equate the idea that we are the future with the idea that we must let adults save us. It is clear that it is not a question of whether or not there are grown-ups in the room. Instead, we must raise our own expectations and confront the internalized adultism that tells us that we don't matter. Societal equality must extend to us. We deserve to have power, and in order to build it, we must learn and practice the skill of struggle. We must organize ourselves. We are no longer the future, we are the present. Other movements will only grow stronger as we empower ourselves to lead them. We must continue to honor the legacies of the young people who came before us, from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee to the Youth Liberation Movement of Ann Arbor, to the children who went on strike from school and faced off against Bull Connor when their parents and civil rights leaders would not. We will dismantle the system of racial capitalism, colonial domination, and human exploitation that manifested the climate crisis. And this starts with our modern education system and continues into the workplace. So, how do I suggest taking on the fight to organize students in schools? My answer would be unions, student unions. Unions of students, for students, and by students are the quintessential representation of any youth climate movement that truly embraces the goals of youth liberation. They allow all youth within them a true chance at self-determination while providing an organizing approach that can employ methods to effectively build and measure power. They are also the logical culmination of a youth climate movement that seeks massive disruption in the form of school strikes. But what does that actually look like? In the United States, student unions refer to buildings on college and university campuses that may or may not sell food, school supplies, and other services to students, support extracurricular student activities, or help to facilitate the cultural life of the student body. This is a far cry from how we think of unions in the context of labor. However, student unions that follow some degree of that model, the labor model that is, are not entirely unprecedented within the United States. A version of them first came to the United States in the 1960s when Black students across the country organized for change on college campuses. The first Black student union began at San Francisco State College in March 1966 as the Negro Student Association before transforming into the San Francisco State BSU. The BSU movement spread to over 1,000 campuses around the country, with many participating in strikes that forced administration to accept more Black students into their college, expand financial aid, and ultimately create Black studies programs. BSUs also held dances and other cultural programs and conducted specific outreach into high schools to recruit more Black kids into college, resulting in tens of thousands of them attending. BSUs are still around today and exist on both college and high school campuses. However, they are closer to school clubs than they are to labor or tenant unions, which are groups that can collectively bargain on behalf of their members. Even further, labor unions have explicit laws protecting their right to organize. If a student union were to exist, there is no singular legislation that governs student unions, nor is there a governance entity that certifies or conducts elections for a group of students that have unionized. While individual students are protected by the First Amendment, the legal precedence for the right of students to organize and be represented by something like a union that collectively bargains on their behalf with school boards and administrations remains unclear within the United States, meaning it's an opportunity to exploit. This is especially true for students 18 and under within our modern K-12 education system, as current U.S. law grants in loco parentis rights to administrations. That just effectively means that administrators and teachers and other staff legally take on the same function and responsibility as that of a parent and hold this role over all students, including those who are 18 and legally considered adults. This gray area means that students engaging in unionization activity could face certain legal risks when it comes to their organizing, including, but not limited to, being expelled from school or getting charged by a court of law with truancy. The ACLU does actually offer some broad guide for the legal rights of students in schools within the US, but they note that that varies by school, district, municipality, and state. Education, post-secondary and primary public school is particularly decentralized in this country. In many other countries, student unions are not simply buildings and are referred to as students, apostrophe, meaning belonging unions. Students' unions often act as the governing body for the students while also providing services such as LGBTQ plus support, healthcare, cultural and sporting activities, and funding for other student organizations. Variations of students' unions exist in other countries at all levels of schooling, from junior high to post-secondary education. One example, Finland, university students are required to join their students' union by law. These unions own and govern student dorms, run multiple newspapers, and offer nursing services for mothers while they go to lectures, in addition to organizing a variety of other activities. Further, Finnish students' unions are very active political powers that engage in the national lawmaking process to push for everything from reduced meal costs to national laws protecting abortion access. Finnish students' unions and others around the world serve as an inspiration for what could be achieved in the United States. Young people are more than just students and workers. We carry with us our entire lives, our neighborhoods, our people. Our project as youth climate justice organizers must be to disrupt adultism by breaking down the artificially engineered isolation of young people. This occurs via our institutionalization in schools, colleges, and workplaces, which are a microcosm of the world in which we live. By disrupting them, we can overcome the oppression of youth everywhere and win a Green New Deal that is abolitionist, decolonial, democratic, internationalist, intersectional and carbon-free, and socialist. This is the project of our generation. In order to take over, it will require unbreakable solidarity from every young person in high schools, colleges, and the workforce. But we can't stop there. We need the solidarity of our parents, teachers, neighborhood leaders, and elders working in coalition with us and following our leadership. We must start at schools and colleges, the institutions where we gather and are subjected to oppression. Then, using proven methods and correct ideas, build power. From there, we will organize the neighborhoods around our schools so that we can affect change not just in our schools, but in our broader communities. In this way, we can build a movement of organized young people committed to disrupting adultism, passing a Green New Deal, and paving the way for our collective liberation. We know climate change is the result of a system of white supremacy. We know that it is upheld by the domineering logic of cisgendered heteronormative patriarchy. We know that it is the culmination of the centuries-long project of imperialism and colonialism. That's why climate change is an intersectional issue. You can't solve it by just focusing on sole environmental policies. It touches on literally everything because, as I like to call it, it's the final boss of racial capitalism. Knowing all of this, Sunrise has rejected those systems and embraced the Green New Deal as a liberatory document that was born of our collective, radical imaginations. So why accept the school system as a barrier to our ability to organize? Why accept the lies that we've been told about how young people behave and how we operate? The reason we should target schools is because schools are a version of society writ small. That is to say, schools are the places which condition us to accept and believe in the American regime of racial capitalism, while simultaneously discouraging us as young people who, from thinking critically about that very same system. Now, just to be clear, this isn't a blanket. This is a pretty broad blanket statement. I know many folks have had teachers that they often remember and can name because they meant a lot in their lives. But on the whole, the system is untenable, Put another way, for young people, schools are the places where we begin to feel that we have to struggle for our freedom. Schools disempower students every day, which is a barrier to radical action for us as organizers, because that's our base. If young people are disempowered, how will we ever be able to build the power we need to win? That needs to change. Our responsibility as organizers is to help everyday people come to their own conclusions about what they need to make their lives better and raise their expectations to believe that they can do something about it. That includes young people, students most of all. If we can't win in schools, how can we expect to win a Green New Deal in the society our school systems replicate? Given the current onslaught on young people by the far right, it is clearer now more than at any point in time since the 1970s that schools are sites of struggle. The question for the youth climate movement, and the youth movement more broadly, is, will we meet the moment and take on the fight? This is an opportunity for us to remember who we are, to remember that we are building a movement of young people across race and class to stop the climate crisis and win a Green New Deal. This is an opportunity for us to remember that we will force the government to end the reign and terror of fossil fuel elites, invest in Black, Brown, and Indigenous and working class communities, and create millions of good paying union jobs. This is an opportunity for us to remember that we're on a mission to put everyday people back in charge and build a world that works for all of us, now and for generations to come. This is an opportunity for us to remember what it is that we do best, which is shine bright. Thank you.
Thank you, Josiah, for a stimulating and thought-provoking lecture. And we'd like to have an opportunity to, I think, take some questions from the audience and have you answer them.
Sure.
So can I summarize? I mean, is that okay for folks, what I got from his lecture? Is that gonna be, too much?
It's 2 minutes before five, just be mindful of people's time.
Yeah. I'm thinking of being very brief. What I got is that you're saying to achieve the Green New Deal for schools that Sunrise is proposing to achieve. And that includes things on their website like integrating sustainability into the curriculum, electrified buses, renewable energy at schools, free lunches, things like that. You are basically saying we need to stop schools from educating students into sort of passivity and obedience and educate them instead into agency and critical thinking and taking charge of their destinies. And that's the way that, students can become the energizing force that connects with other people in the community and helps us build this movement to create a national Green New Deal by maybe community by community to build momentum to that end, creating Green New Deals. Is that
That's pretty much it. The only accurate exception I would have is the Green New Deal for schools being a specific program by Sunrise. I would say I actually just mean that I'm a Green New Deal, period.
Okay. Thank you. So let's open it up to questions now. Yes, do you need a microphone or?
No, I'm good.
Great. You have a good, strong voice.
For the school to pipeline, the school to prison pipeline scenario you were talking about, are you also including the zero tolerance that schools are implementing in most like grade schools and like high schools around the country? Are you also focusing on that as well?
Yeah, so more broadly, the school to prison pipeline, if we think about it as, and the role it plays in terms of when we view schools as car surveillance and punishment of particularly black and brown students. So of course that includes zero tolerance policies. I'd also say that there's, I didn't get into this in the lecture, but a good way to think about schools themselves as carceral sites, rather than just as funneling, you know, folks into the school-to-prison pipeline, is that schools, education competes for state budgets. And one of the most effective ways that they've seen their budgets grow is actually by enacting the same policies and practices as policing and carceral institutions, which absorb most significant portions of the state budget. We put a lot of money into things like incarceration and the like. And so schools began to mimic over time those things because they said, we need more money for metal detectors. If you see in response to any school shooting, like, we need metal detectors, right? Or we need money for security guards, or we need money for, you know, I mean, in some states, arming teachers, right? And so a great way of thinking about it is that the very policies, all of them, which are intended to surveil, target, and punish students, are those that are, in general, what schools utilize to become carceral sites in and of themselves.
Other questions? Yes, you're on.
I'll ask a question. So thank you, first off, for an amazing talk. I think that was just hugely insightful. I wanted to ask your opinion about semantics, actually. We hear a lot about environmental justice, climate justice, social justice. My question to you is, do you feel like these terms are synonymous? Is there a need to have separation of these terms and a separate definition for each of these terms?
I'd say that, well, okay, first of all, I'm all about semantics. If you're an organizer worth your salt, you better be about the semantics. And I honestly just think, one, first of all, part of the evolution of language, right? It started as the environmental justice movement, right? And it actually didn't start as the environmental justice, let me reframe that. But climate justice has kind of became a term that emerged out of, one, the pre-existing environmental work. And, you know, the reason climate justice and framing it as climate justice is important is because it is all-encompassing, right? When you think about the role of, I mean, I talk about this all the time, people don't think about the role that the slave trade had on the impact of climate change, when or had on, like, you know, the environment. When the slave trade happened, you know, the triangle slave trade in the Atlantic, the amount of bodies that were dumped overboard changed the migration patterns of sharks. When the indigenous genocide in the Americas occurred, there was a global cooling because so many bodies were dead, no longer, you know, emitting bodily heat, that the global temperature dropped. So many people died as a consequence of the murder and, the murder of indigenous peoples, that we instituted what was a tantamount to a mini ice age. And so when we think about, you know, the role of, like, or when we think about the language of climate justice, the reason we say climate is because it touches literally everything.
Another hand.
Yeah.
I was just wondering. You talked about about the mainstream climate movement, and there's many different organizations and movements being done all over the U.S. How would you approach understanding that a movement or an organization is not greenwashing in order to gain publicity, instead of actually carrying and bringing nonprofits or anything into, I don't know if it's making sense, but I'm just trying to get by. How would you understand that an organization is really being truthful about their actions and about what they're stating that they're going to be doing in order in the climate movement exactly?
Oh, okay. For the online folks. Which is that, how would one come to look at any organization that is doing any organizing or is in any relationship with climate justice, environmental justice, and understand that it is
either greenwashing or not greenwashing, and claiming, you know, that they are good for the environment when they're actually not. I think to answer this, I would say that my orientation towards everything is about power. And this is, of course, speaking specifically to organizations that do organizing, like Sunrise Movement or Extinction Rebellion or Youth Versus Apocalypse in the Bay Area, all kinds of organizations. If the organization is not grounded in a particular place, right? That doesn't mean that, like, you know, it can't, like, you know, you're a national organization and you only have, like, an office in D.C. or something like that. Although that's the first warning sign. But if the organization does not come from a particular people, right? If I'm saying I organize in L.A., but I can't tell you anything about L.A., then that's your first red flag. But the second thing I would say is that, like, when it comes to understanding greenwashing, it really is just about the relationship that the organization has to its people. Because greenwashing, I mean, you could green anything, right? I mean, you could literally paint the building green and say it's green, you know, and it'd be fine and people would believe you. Nobody would gut check it or anything like that. So honestly, the best assessment for any of this comes down to whether or not you actually see a direct relationship between the people who are of the land and from the land and the organization that claims to represent those people.
Well, let's give a big round of applause one more time and thank you to Josiah. We really appreciate you coming out today, and we want to thank all of you for coming. I hope you enjoy the rest of your Earth Week. We still have a few other events this week as well. On Friday, I think, right? Is the
tomorrow we have a green building tour of the new health and wellness facility and also some breath work, because again, sustainability is about health and wellness. So if you're interested, please sign up, check out the Eventbrite. The following day we have a tour of several things: the makerspace over off of Temple, as well as the Reach Garden, the Demonstration Garden, the Sustainability Garden. We'll walk through the farm, go through the koi pond. It'll be a nice extensive tour, so if you're interested, please check that out as well.
Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your afternoon.